Hey guys, this is Marcos Vidalis from Savage Gear Assault, and I'm here today to introduce you the lead engineer behind this amazing project. Mr. Robert Valdo. How are you doing, Robert?
Yeah, I'm good. How are you?
I'm okay.
All right, good to see you.
Me too. I was looking forward to have this conversation with you.
All right.
I have many things that we have to discuss. You know, Robert, in saltwater, we crave for a really good casting distance. Actually, it's one of the most important advantages a reel can have.
Yeah.
And I saw that these reels really cast far. I need you to tell me, is this because of the perfect line management that I noticed about the spool, or how did you make this happen?
Again, like with many things, it's a combination. We have used during our testing our own Savage Gear braid. So the line lay, we made it that perfect because we adjusted the gearing, the oscillation, to be the right, to give the right result for when it comes to line lay. So that's one thing. Another thing, and also very important, is the spool lip.
Okay.
You know, when we started testing, we sent out a lot of different spools, and the spool basically was not that different except for the spool lip. And then we took all the feedback from you guys, which was performing best when it comes to castability. This is the end result, and this is for us what we think is the optimal angle in spool lip. So when you cast, then there is not a lot of friction when the line leaves the spool.
That's true.
That's basically what we did. So it's a combination of making sure you have the right line lay, and in this case, the spool lip.
And that was also what I noticed, because when I casted, I couldn't hear the noise of the braid touching the lip. It was like a...
The more resistance it creates,
yes,
the less distance you get. And that's something you want to avoid.
Really, really cool. Then, I also noticed a very, very good performance of the drags. And I try actually to take a peek inside and watch them. I saw that they have a very big surface.
Yeah.
But for sure, it's not just that. What else is behind the...
No, that's correct. One of the things is we use the right grease. We come back to the grease. But our Dura grease is inside the drag system as well, so it provides you a very smooth grease drag. At the same time, the drag washes that we use are kind of special. It's one layer of carbon, fiberglass, and a third layer is also carbon again.
Okay.
They will be pressed together.
Uh-huh.
So we have basically a reasonably thick drag washer.
Mm-hmm.
The big advantage there is that if you think that your drag system is showing some wear, you know, after a while, it can be a bit bumpy. You can lose some drag power, and it takes a long time, but
it can happen, of course.
Exactly.
Yes.
Exactly. What you then do is take the drag washers out, turn them around, and then you basically use this second layer of carbon.
Okay.
You put them in again, and you have a brand new drag system.
Whoa.
Like it's coming from the shop.
I see you talking a lot about our new Dura grease.
Yes. Yeah.
I'm very sure, and I kind of love it too, because what I did is that one of the samples that I put a lot inside, and I went fishing, and I tried to do something that is very often happened to our areas.
Mm-hmm.
With a temperature of 43 degrees, I left the reel in the sun for several hours until it reached 80 degrees, the external temperature, the metal.
It's metal, it collects the heat.
Exactly. Yeah. And I didn't notice a single drop of melted grease coming out. And believe me, it's a very, very often problem in my area to see reels with grease coming liquid outside during use or when you left them in the sun. How is this possible? Why the grease didn't melt?
We created our own grease. You know, it took a lot of time to get to this point. We did a lot of testing with several formulas. First of all, it's non-toxic. You know, it's a topic nowadays. So we thought, all right, if we're going to do something with grease, then it needs to be non-toxic as
well.
The second thing is that most greases out there on the market, they have an operational window, but when things start becoming below 10 degrees Celsius, north of Norway, here in Denmark, for example,
yes,
then the grease tends to be getting thicker.
Thicker, yes.
The other way, if it goes up in temperature, it gets thinner.
I know, yeah? Well.
Especially when it's getting thicker, then the first thing that fails is your anti-reverse.
Yes.
That's the first thing. And quite a few reels out there on the market, they have it.
Yes.
They have that problem. So what we are looking for is not only the production needs to be there, it needs to create smoothness in your gearing, but also this operational window of the grease needs to be right. This grease that we use here in our reels stays stable between minus 30 Celsius and 160 degrees Celsius. In that window,
yes,
it doesn't change in thickness.
I don't believe that anyone will fish in different temperatures like this. Huh?
Yeah.
They are already extreme.
Exactly.
Very
exactly.
Good. In general, the total performance is really, really, really smooth. I know it's part of the grease. I know it's part of the gear. But I can see that every detail about the handle length, about everything on this reel, they seem that they are feedbacks of anglers.
Exactly, yeah.
How many anglers involved in this project, Robert?
A lot, really a lot. You know, we have connections in Australia. We have our own office in Miami, in the US. They have a lot of pro staff anglers as well there. So we use them for testing. You were heavily involved.
This is exactly what I'm talking about.
Our colleague Michoviel, he was heavily involved. A lot of these guys were involved. So this is the end result. And again, like I said, what we try to create is to bring something extra on the market that's not there yet. And I think with the saltwater resistance of our reel, the drag system, the grease, I think we nailed it. And that can only be done when you talk to anglers.
Let's talk about the worst fear of all metals in salt water. Salt water itself.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's probably like an acid.
Yeah.
Our salt water has 33 grams of salt per liter.
Okay, that's a lot.
It's a huge amount of salt that can destroy even the higher-end reels out there.
Yeah.
But you told me to spray them, and I didn't only spray them, I didn't tell you what I did. Actually, I covered them with a soft cloth of salt water and leave them on shadow and sprayed every second day. I did that for 10 days, and then I take it out. And the reel was completely intact.
Yeah.
Then I did something else. I scratched the body, and I did it one more time. And I saw on the scratched area the coat, not, it hadn't blow and make small pieces. It remained exactly.
Yeah.
What on earth did you use? And you probably some alien material or something, because it's not possible. This is really one of the biggest things that took my attention about that and brought me into this conversation. That was one of the things that I really wanted to discuss with you.
No, normally, a saltwater reel, 9 out of 10, the saltwater test is that they put a reel into a tank and they spray every hour with saltwater on the reel. And they do that for 1 week, day and night.
Okay.
168 hours.
So you have lots of salt and oxygen, the worst conditions to make corrosion.
That's basically, I wouldn't say the standard, but that's what 9 out of 10 saltwater reels is getting treated with.
Okay.
If they pass that test, then in the business they say it's saltwater resistant.
Okay.
What we did the same thing, but not for 168 hours, 500 hours.
Whoa.
So for 500 hours in that tank, every hour, spray saltwater. And it survived.
Yes.
I've seen the pictures and it survived. And that's what we call SRC 500.
Okay.
Saltwater resistance coating. 500 for the hours, of course.
Yes, yes.
And it's unique for our reels. And again, that's what is making this saltwater resistance in our reels a lot better than what's out there on the market.
Okay, tell me something else. We have two series, SGS6 and SGS8.
Correct, yeah.
They really feel smooth and they feel the same. Did you use same ball bearings? Actually, what kind of ball bearings you used? Because we saltwater anglers have a passion with good ball bearings.
It's a must. You know, it's I always say that the number of ball bearings is not so relevant. It's about the quality.
Totally agree. Totally agree.
For saltwater reels, you need very good ball bearings, of course. So the first thing that you do is you take sealed stainless steel ball bearings.
Yes.
That's a must when you go into
saltwater. Yeah, you cannot use something else.
At the same time, there are differences in quality like you have with everything else. So you can get ball bearings from India. They have a very good reputation. Japan, of course. We are using Japanese ball bearings in some of our reels. And even in Japan, you have different brands.
Okay.
So you can use also different quality.
Of Japanese bearings. Ball bearings.
Exactly, yeah.
So
yeah.
Details like this also justifies the price difference
between of course,
the two.
Yeah.
Excellent, yeah. Excellent. So, Robert, let me get that straight. Okay, we have two series of reels from 4,000 to 18,000 sizes.
Yes.
So practically you can do most saltwater fishing styles available. Okay.
And 14,000 sizes in high speed.
Whoa, okay. And then you have a perfect drag system, a powerful gear system, excellent casting, excellent line laying, a very balanced mass to weight body. You have perfect length handles. Actually, I can see that you made something really, really good for our needs.
We did it together. Like I said, I need the angler for this as well. You know, I don't spend too much time at the water.
And the most important, this is completely our own reel. Everything on this is designed by us, even the smallest detail.
We start from scratch. I think so.
A reel from scratch.
A reel from scratch.
Amazing.
Absolutely.
Thank you very, very much, Robert.
And don't forget, 1st of September, they're in the shop.
A lot of happy saltwater anglers from 1st of September.
And this is only part one, right?
Ah, I know what's coming.
You know that.
You will see what's coming, guys. Believe me. Actually, you won't believe. Thank you, guys.